Ciao tutti, bentornati o benvenuti a TM1 Nybble's Technology Information in under 16 minutes. This episode is off schedule. I was not planning to do an episode on specific aspects of TM1 before doing introductory episodes, and I wasn't planning to do those until I'm able to get Planning Analytics 2, the latest version, up and running. And hello, Docker, a Linux abomination which sits between the Windows-based TM1 server and the Windows-based TM1 client. Actually, I do have Docker installed, and I do have it running. I just can't get it to talk to anything, but I digress. I am making this episode now because it's a problem that has been coming up regularly at my own workplace. I'm sure I'm not the only one. It relates to an issue that was covered in the Windows Tips and Tricks subseries, specifically Nybble 050, but there are some special aspects of it which relate to TM1 and to Windows 10. The problem occurs when you log into a server on the TM1 Server Explorer, so let's just go ahead and do that now. So far, so good. We'll open up a cube. So far, so good. We can even recalculate the cube. And that's all fine and dandy, but when we go to change the settings that we have selected by, say, clicking on the subset tile, nothing seems to happen. And when we click, we get pinged at consistently, persistently, constantly, in fact. Che disastro! È rotto! No, actually, it's not broken, and something did actually happen. The subset editor that you just called up opened, but it opened way the hell over there somewhere. So how does this happen? Some applications keep track of where you last opened a window and will try to open it at the same location. Now, when I say location, you probably know that a screen is made up of a rectangle of boxes called picture elements or pixels. This defines the screen's resolution. So a lot of notebooks, for example, other than a lot of the gutless wonders that manufacturers still seem to be able to flog to the unwary, might have a resolution of, say, 1920 pixels across by 1080 high, or 1600 across by 900 high. Some applications, of which TM1 is one, will remember how many pixels across and how many pixels down the last location of one of its windows was. Now, this worked really, really well back in the days when Seinfeld was producing weekly episodes and when a 17-inch CRT monitor was considered the height of luxury. It works less well in the modern era of hot desking, where you will often be plugging your notebook in and out of a much higher resolution monitor. So if you're plugged into a monitor which might have a display resolution of, say, 2560 by 1440, especially when you work in extended screen mode, you may have last opened the subset editor at, say, 2,000 pixels from the left. Except, your notebook has only 1920 pixels. So if you're just using your notebook display or just duplicating your notebook display, the window opens off screen. So when TM1 just keeps dinging at you, it isn't frozen, it isn't rope broken, it isn't locked up. It's just waiting for you to tell it what you want to do with the window that you can't see. And incidentally, this is likely to happen with any software interface that works the same way. There are three principal ways around this. The first one is the Windows key plus the left or right arrow key. Now, this worked without fail in Windows 7, and as with many things, works whenever it naffing feels like it in Windows 10. Let's look at the specifics of this a little bit further. When you drag a window to the border, when you see your mouse pointer, not the window, but the actual mouse pointer, watch what happens when my mouse pointer hits the border. You'll see that there is a pulse, and now there's a ghosted area over on the right-hand side. And when I release it, that window is then docked to the right-hand side, and all the rest turn up as these little windows down here. Now, this drives a lot of people to distraction because they don't know why it's happening, and there is a way to turn it off, which I'll come to in a moment. A side effect of this default setting, though, is that you can use the Windows plus arrow keys to achieve the same effect. So I'm just going to restore that back to where it was. Okay, now if I hit the Windows key and the right arrow key, you will see that it automatically docks over to the side. If I now hit the Windows key and the left arrow key, it returns it to the center. If I hit the Windows key and the left arrow key again, both together obviously, it will go to the left-hand side. If I do Windows up, it will maximize. If I do Windows down, it will go back to a restored state if it's already maximized, and then go down to the taskbar. Now, on Windows 7, this also worked if the window was off-screen, which is what led me to comment on it rather favorably in the earlier Nybble episode. But in Windows 10, I have found, and I have found many, many, many posts and articles and discussions about this, it only works sometimes. Okay, I mentioned turning it off. I shall do so for the purposes of completeness, although this was covered in the earlier Nybble as well, in the Start menu. Now, I use Classic Shell because I cannot abide the Tiles interface, but I'll go to it anyway, just for you, my dear viewers. And you can type in Ease of Access Center. Okay, so you can then click on Ease of Access Center.
Always scan this section.
And then you tell Microsoft Windows to shut up. And you can then go to Make the Mouse Easier to Use. And there is this option here, Prevent Windows from being automatically arranged when they move to the side of the screen. Not exactly the most intuitively obvious place for this control to be, but that's where it is. Now, I used to actually check that box to turn this setting off back in the early days of Windows 7, but then I came to appreciate the ability of it to move the window to the right place, so I don't do it any longer. Whether you decide to leave it on or off, it's up to you. The second option is to use the keyboard to move the window so that you can bring it back into the visible area using some keyboard commands that have been largely forgotten in the mists of time. Now, note that this will only work if you haven't clicked on something else in the meantime and have realized what is happening. Obviously, if you have clicked on something else, so let me just open up cash flow here and I shall repeat the same process. So ding, 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 ding. Then maybe I go and click on that. Uh-oh, I can't do this trick anymore. You don't have to go to the task manager and kill Excel. You don't have to reboot the computer. Just click on the disconnect button, and that will disconnect you from any TM1 servers, close down all of the windows, and then you can just start again. So I'll just go back and log in. Okay, so we're back to where we started. I'll just hit the subset editor again. Now, we know that the subset editor is over there. Okay, how do we get it back? We start by typing Alt plus Spacebar. Now, what that does is that it activates the window menu, the often forgotten about window menu of a standard window. And you can see that the menu pops up way over on the right, telling you that the host window is over there somewhere. You can then type M for move, and then you can just press your left arrow key. Now, this might take a little while for it to come back, depending on how far to the right it actually is, but it will come back over here and the mouse pointer will be stuck to the top there. So you now wiggle it around a little bit, click on that, and then just click OK. And after that, of course, that now becomes the last location that you opened the window, and everything will be fine and dandy. The third option is to change the location that TM1 has remembered. Now, the location of the window is saved in a file in your application data directory. If you don't know what an application data directory or app data directory is, I do suggest that you watch Nybble's 10, 20, and 30, which tell you everything that you need to know about them. But for now, just know that it is where programs store some data and some settings. Now, before you do this, close down Excel and close down TM1. Then go to Windows Explorer and in the address bar, type %appdata, APPDATA, one word, no spaces, and with the percentage signs on either side. This is called an environment variable. You will find the information you need about environment variables in earlier episodes of TM1 Nybbles. Press Enter, and you'll be taken to your AppData roaming directory, where you will find a folder called Applix. Applix was the name of the company that originally marketed TM1. In there, you will find a TM1 folder, and there you will find TM1P.ini. If you do not see TM1P.ini, then you probably have your file extensions turned off. They should be turned on for reasons that I discussed in Nybble 040 on Windows 10 tips and tricks, because that is really a bad setting to have off. So, TM1P ini, you can just open that up in a text editor, so Notepad, for example, or I can do it with Notepad++. So I'm just going to double click on it to open it up. It will probably open in Notepad. It depends on what your settings are. If not, you can just manually open it in Notepad. Just open up Notepad, go File, Open, go to that location and open it up there. Now, you can see that some of these settings, these are all of the settings that relate to your TM1 client. If you're using the classic client, of course, the one that we've been looking at, the Server Explorer one, you'll see that there are three settings that relate to the location of Windows, and you will see that one of them has an x-coordinate of 4000. Obviously, I've deliberately fudged that so that I can simulate what happens when you plug into a larger monitor, so that's why it's been opening off-screen for me. Now, you can actually tweak these settings if you know what they are, but you can also just delete them. So you can go main window layout info, doesn't really matter. Subset editor, subset window layout info, doesn't really matter. You can just delete them. And you can even do that with a security assignment window layout, although you won't see that unless you're an administrator. And yes, you can just delete that too. And you will not do any harm because this is basically a self-healing file. Even if you delete the entire file, and I do not encourage you to do that, but even if you did, then the file would just regenerate itself next time. But then you would have to go through and set all of the relevant information, such as the path to your SSL certificate and the name of your admin host and so on and so forth, which is why I don't recommend deleting it. But you can delete individual settings like that out of there without doing any harm whatsoever. So I'm just going to close that down and save it. So I'm going to go back and reopen TM1. I'll speed through this. And now if we open up the subset editor, it will just open up in the default location, the factory default location, and we will not have any further problems. So those are your three options. First, try the Windows arrow keys. Second, try using Alt plus spacebar immediately after you have clicked on one of these windows, and then use the left arrow to bring it back across. And the third one is just go into your INI file and just delete the coordinates, resave the INI file. Remember to have Excel closed at the time so that the new settings will apply to the new session, and you are done. Especially with the last two, the problem just goes away. And with that, your time is done. If you enjoyed this episode, or better still, found it useful, it would be greatly appreciated if you would hit the like button, subscribe if you'd like to do so. Although at the time of recording, I will be honest with you, bites and nibbles are only an intermittent thing until I can get PA2 running properly and until Office 2019 arrives, and leave any comments that you'd care to do so. But until next time, goodbye.